center-state relations cover many, many dimensions. Political, financial, budgeting, conduct of elections, judiciary, amendment. These are all at the heart of center-state relations. But what I propose to do with you in the short period of time that I have is to try and share with you my experiences in some cases I've done, and also talk about some recent developments that will show you the fault lines between the center and the states. In my understanding, there are certain areas in which the center and the states collaborate well, what people today call cooperative federalism. That's the catchword. And cooperative federalism is a good catchword going forward, because it contemplates cooperation of both. It requires states to go two steps forward to work in sync with the center, and equally requires the center to look out for the states, including states where the center is not in power. So I think that's a good doctrine and a very balanced doctrine to build on. But it's not that states and the center collaborate in all cases. In fact, in many cases, they're at cross purposes. And one of the areas where states and the center are at cross purposes is in the matter of legislation. And this is where you will find a good deal of friction. When I say friction, it's a very sophisticated friction, in the sense it doesn't lead to civil war or violence, God forbid. But what it does lead to is a certain degree of difference of attitude and priority when it comes to legislation. And who are the arbiters there? It's the courts. I want to link up our conversation now to what we spoke about in the morning. Center-state relations is not an academic topic. It's a burning topic today in legal practice. It's a matter that you will hopefully engage with and get into, because you'll find it's a very fascinating area of study. And it's not easy to read the Indian Constitution and to come to conclusions. As you know, the Indian Constitution has been subjected to multiple interpretations, and even today, interpretations are at large. Even today, the scope of Article 21 is being debated. Now, I want to begin by giving you a couple of examples of where I felt that the state and the center have been at cross purposes to each other in the manner or in the matter of legislation. Under the Constitution, I think you're aware, the respective power of the state and the center comes from Schedule 7, List 1 as far as the center is concerned, List 2 as far as the states are concerned, and then a concurrent list. It seems clear enough, though some people have said the residuary power in the concurrent list must also be allotted to the states, but those are scholars who support a more heavy role for the states. But the manner in which the Indian Constitution works is that, apart from List 1 and List 2, when legislations find themselves in List 3, it's the center that prevails. And in case of repugnancy, it's the central law that always prevails over the states. But these are again doctrinal. What law falls under which entry of which list itself is not an easy question to answer. And this is where the debates arise, this is where the differences arise, and this is where the courts step in. Now let me give you an example. As we speak, there is a case going on in the High Court of Karnataka, which is looking at the interplay of the new Land Acquisition Act and some of the state enactments, such as the Karnataka Industrial Development Board Act, the KIADB Act. Now, as you know, the new Land Acquisition Act has brought about a sea change in acquisition law. It's more land loser friendly, provides for higher rates of compensation, sometimes so high that it's unviable for projects to even take off. Net-net, it is twice the market value of land, and I have seen in some cases that people have indulged in a sort of black marketing to try and create a false real estate boom in areas where lands are being acquired, as a result of which lands have skyrocketed. And for states to be paying that kind of compensation is prohibitive. The counter argument, of course, is equally compelling, that if the land belonging to land losers is taken away from them, right to property is no longer a fundamental right, then the very least that the state can do is pay healthy compensation, especially when farmlands are involved. So that debate is raging. But purely from a legislative perspective, it's a very ticklish issue. The question arises whether the new Land Acquisition Act prevails over the Karnataka Industrial Area Development Boards Act or not. And why that question is relevant is that if the new act applies, the central act prevails, then compensation is payable under the new act, number one. Number two, the new act, that's the central act, has crucial provisions with respect to lapsing of acquisition, where awards are not made within a prescribed period of time, where possession is not taken, where compensation is not deposited. These are all pro-landowner provisions which say that if there's been inordinate delay, without getting into the nitty-gritty, inordinate delay on the part of the state in acquiring and compensating the land loser, then the acquisition proceedings would lapse. Now the question would be whether an acquisition made under the state enactment would be at cross purposes or loggerheads with the central act. And this question is to be decided purely on law. As far as the landowners are concerned, they prefer the more beneficial legislation, which is the central act. The central act, in fact, traces its roots to entry 44 of list 3, which is a concurrent list entry. And it provides that even if there are state enactments that are operating with respect to land acquisition, they will only be allowed to operate insofar as they are more beneficial to the landowner. That's all very well. But the ticklish question to be decided, and why I'm using this as a test case, is that interpreting legislative entries vis-a-vis Articles 246, 254 and others of the Constitution is not so easy. And why I say that is, now the KIADB Act is not in itself an acquisition act. It's an Industrial Area Development Act. It traces itself to an entry 22 in list 2, which is a state list entry. By incidence, it has provisions that deal with acquisition as well, for the purpose of implementing the industrial policy of the state. Obviously, the industrial policy of the state is dependent, amongst other things, on the availability of a land bank, which can then be allotted to new industries for development. I'm keeping the moral argument out of it. I know it's a key debate to what extent should states acquire land. Invariably, large tracts of land that are required are farmlands. Let's be frank. You don't have urban lands available anymore in large measure. And there's a moral argument there, but we'll keep that for later. But the interesting question that arises here is, which prevails? On first principles, if both acts are traceable to the concurrent list, it's a no-brainer that the state enactment will yield to the central act. But on the other hand, if a state enactment is able to trace itself to the state list, then the doctrine of repugnancy would not arise. And how have courts understood that over time? By applying the doctrine of pith and substance. That a single enactment may not entirely fall under one entry. But the question is, in pith and substance, in its very essence, which entry does it predominantly fall under? And if the essence of that enactment falls under list 2, which according to us is industries, then the question of repugnancy does not arise. Now, this is not a case where the center and the state are at political cross purposes. Let me be fair. In fact, the center in this case has taken no stand because it has nothing to say. The center has enacted the Land Acquisition Act. It's now a dispute between the state and the landowners, and the courts will decide. And in fact, the Supreme Court has ruled frequently on such disputes, even with respect to land acquisition. And I hope that some of you will pay attention to this new and emerging area. I was talking to you in the morning about GST, IBC, competition, etc. I think the application of the new Land Acquisition Act is going to be something which you need to keep an eye on. And the courts have decided these questions. The court has, in fact, the Supreme Court has decided this question in the context of the Bangalore Development Authorities Act and said that the BDA Act has provisions with respect to acquisition of land, but in pith and substance it is not an acquisition act. In pith and substance it is an act dealing with town planning, development and land, all of which fall under list 2, and therefore the Central Land Acquisition Act will not prevail over the BDA Act. There is no direct precedent on the KIDB Act, but there are precedents on other industrial development acts of other states, for example Maharashtra. The KIDB Act has been interpreted by the Supreme Court in several cases, though maybe not directly on this point. And if one looks at those judgments, you conclude that industrial development acts are essentially relatable to industries and not to acquisition. You will find Supreme Court cases which talk about the interplay between land and forest provisions. In fact, there is a judgment, I think, from Uttarakhand, if I am not wrong, where the Supreme Court held that the enactment there was predominantly concerned with land, which is a list 2 subject. It coincidentally dealt with forests, and therefore it was not a list 3 enactment, and therefore the state act would prevail. Supreme Court has said this in the context of acquisition of sugarcane undertakings, holding that it is not a legislation in pith and substance dealing with acquisition of land, it's more a legislation dealing with the industries related to sugarcane. It's very interesting, friends. I began by telling you we have a fairly clear demarcation, list 1, list 2, list 3, repugnancy, etc. But it's in the working of the legislations that you begin to see the pressure points. And they have serious consequences. They have serious consequences for the state. In a case like this, if the Central Act is applied, a good deal of acquisition is undone. It either lapses or the compensation payable is twice. And therefore, these are key issues that will be arising as we go forward in dealing with this interplay between central enactments and state laws. I tell you that, in fact, the learned single judge of the Karnataka High Court has already taken a view in the matter, holding that the Central Act will prevail. The matter is in appeal, the judgment has been stayed, and therefore the matter is still very much res integra. I'll give you another example of an interesting interface between central and state acts. I'm not yet getting into the slightly more politically sensitive issues. I'm coming to it. I know last night some of you were talking to me about the proposal for a flag in Karnataka and so on. I'm going to talk about that. The language issue, food, beef. These are hot issues now. But I'll give you one other example of an interplay between a central and a state provision. I think many of you will be aware that the Indian Constitution was amended to introduce provisions in Part 9 which deal with panchayats. It's a very key amendment to the Constitution to provide for grassroots decentralization. It's worked fairly well, in some cases not so well. That's a different matter. But it was a big paradigm shift in the Indian Constitution to delegate power. It's very interesting. It's a constitutional amendment, obviously initiated by the center, supported by the states, but results in delegation of power. Please look at the very subtle way in which Indian federalism plays itself out. For you to amend the Constitution, in most cases, the center has to take the consent of the states involved. The Constitution under Article 368 spells out any amendment to Part 3, Part 4, any amendment pertaining to the power to amend the Constitution, etc., requires ratification of the states. States have ratified amendments to the Constitution dealing with NJAC, more recently with respect to GST, and I'll be coming back to those. And therefore there is an inherent check in the Indian Constitution when it comes to amending the Constitution, keeping in mind the interests of the states. We always look at the power to amend from a basic structure perspective, from a fundamental rights violation perspective, etc. But please also remember there is one other constituent under the constitutional framework, and that is the states themselves. And they can't be taken for granted. And therefore, key amendments require the ratification of the states. Now, this amendment to Part 9, introducing Article 243Z, etc., was a key exercise in decentralization brought about by amending the constitution and led to delegation of powers. Now, as a result of this, a number of states enacted legislations. States had provisions introduced relating to Panchayat Raj governance. Many of those provisions provide for tenure of members of the Panchayat, their powers, their obligations, etc. And it was a very interesting legislative, constitutional and legislative manner in which this decentralization was brought about. Now, recently, I was engaged to argue a matter before the Karnataka High Court for the state, where one of the petitioners had contended that a particular provision in the Karnataka Panchayat Raj Act was at cross purposes with Part 9 of the Constitution, by which special provisions for the Panchayat Raj, for the Panchayats were introduced. And that's a fair point. Any provision in a statute which is ultra virus to the Constitution has to succumb. But interestingly, and this matter is still sub judice, so I don't want to say too much, but interestingly we found in the course of our research that the Gujarat High Court, a division bench judgment, had held that the very amendment to the constitution introducing provisions with respect to panchayats itself was violative of the basic structure. And in doing so, the Gujarat High Court held that panchayats are basically covered by list 2, and therefore there was no question of introducing them by amendment. It's a very new line of thinking. It's gone to the Supreme Court. It's going to be surely looked at much more closely, because this is a case not just of central legislation but of constitutional amendment. And of course, amendments to the constitution can be tested, as you know, after Keshavan and Bharti, on the touchstone of basic structure. But can they be tested on the question of legislative competence, especially when states are involved in ratification? And this is going to be a very, very interesting, in my view, maybe not today, people may not be talking about it today. These are not cases that have high glamour. They're not all over Twitter and news channels. But these are very, very interesting aspects which I would request you to follow and participate in, because they're going to set the tone for Indian federalism, at least as far as constitutional law is concerned. These may not be political hotbeds as such, though in many ways they are. States and panchayats, there is a very interesting political interplay there. I can't go into that now. And state governments very keenly follow and observe the manner in which panchayat elections are conducted. State governments very keenly look at the way municipal elections are conducted. You know Bombay? Bombay corporation elections are as big as a state election in some ways, because they are held to be trendsetters. So let's not fool ourselves. Grassroots politics is very, very keen in India today. And you're seeing that. You're even seeing that, friends, in the manner in which central leadership is taking shape in the country today. India is not a Delhi-centric style of governance anymore. Our Prime Minister was never in central politics. And he has come to power through state elections. People have voted for a different style of governance. People have said that state leaders can hold fort even at the center. And that is also, in my opinion, a marked sea change if you look at it objectively. We've been accustomed all along to a style of governance which was very central. The Congress Party, of course, has ruled us for many, many years, many decades, with very short breaks in between. Of course, it has ruled at state level as well. But typically, at a national level, it was only national leaders who held fort. Your cabinet invariably was from the center. How often did you see state leaders at the political high table in New Delhi? Not always. Let me tell you, you can check this up. Today that trend has changed. A lot of your key leaders at the center are in fact new to New Delhi. And therefore, that in my limited understanding is a reflection of the manner in which the political wind is blowing. That people have begun to see that there is a scope for a bottom-up approach. People, I think, and the Indian voter is very intelligent. People have begun to see that there is need to engage more with local leadership. But to return to this aspect, within the constitution, you find that this interplay when it comes to conflict between entries in the lists, the powers of the center to legislate and so on, are always right vis-a-vis judicial review. And courts are constantly grappling with this question of legislative competence and interplay between the powers. And this is very crucial because it's what you call a jurisdictional issue. As you know, a statute can be challenged as unconstitutional, not only if it violates Part 3, it can first and solely be challenged on the question of legislative competence. And if legislature is unable to show you its power to legislate, whether it's a good law or a bad law is immaterial. I told you in the morning, I gave you an example of an apprenticeship that some of us had undergone. Why was it struck down by the Supreme Court? Because it was held to be ultra-virus. Not so much on a question of pure legislative competence, but ultra-virus, the powers of the Bar Council under the Bar Council Act. The principle is the same. If you don't have the power to make the regulation, whether it's a good regulation or a bad regulation is immaterial. Only when you cross that stage does the next question arise. Does it violate Article 14? Does it violate Article 19? Does it violate 21? Liquor, for example. I'm told there's a proposal in your state to go dry. Maybe some of you are quite disappointed by that. But when it comes to prohibition cases, which have been challenged in the courts for many, many years, the principles are very clear. Liquor is res extra commercium. You don't have a fundamental right to trade in liquor. Well, prohibition is policy. And invariably, prohibition has been upheld. Even in Kerala, where there was a phased prohibition, the Supreme Court upheld it. And the questions that will arise there are one of legislative competence. Now, liquor is a state subject. Supposing the Union of India decides to make India a dry country, it may be a good policy in the eyes of some. But does the Union have the power? The answer is no. And then, if an enactment is brought of that sort, it will be tested and it will be struck down. I'll give you another very interesting example. I had written a paper many years ago, even before this BCCI issue became what it is, about the need for a cricket legislation. I had argued that the manner in which cricket has grown in India and its dimensions to affect various aspects of public life, the new introduction of doping, match fixing, spectator safety, contracts, finances, etc., is something that could no longer be left to the BCCI, which many of you will know is simply a private society registered under the West Bengal Societies Registration Act. When people, sorry?
I think it's
Tamil Nadu Societies Registration Act. Fair enough. It's still a state society. Fair enough. I stand for it. When people say you're picked to play for India, you're actually being picked by a society registered in Tamil Nadu. And that becomes your national team. And these are key questions to be asked. And these are questions that the Supreme Court dealt with in BCCI's case and ultimately held by a narrow majority that no writ was maintainable against the BCCI because it was not state. Because it was a private society. And if you read the minority judgment in the BCCI case, you'll see what a compelling case was made out. You can't on the one hand say this is the national team, have the whole country going berserk over it, have people committing suicide, losing money, gambling is unregulated, and then to sit back and say this is a private enterprise. Then why can't there be a second Indian team? If one society can pick an Indian team, why can't another? It may happen that with the acquiescence of the sports ministry in New Delhi, an Indian team was picked, but sport is not a central subject. This is the point I want to make. sport under the constitution is a state subject. Now you have a central sports ministry for what it's worth, but supposing the Union of India decides that cricket in India, being the equivalent of, let's say, what football is in Brazil and so on, requires regulation, not necessarily through the Supreme Court. As you know, today cricket is being regulated because of a Supreme Court order. And why did the Supreme Court step in, right or wrong? Because there was no other regulation. But today the Union of India decides to regulate cricket. It has no power to legislate, however good its intentions may be. Not to talk, friends, about the situation in NCT, in Delhi. Delhi is a peculiar situation. Union Territory has a house, has a lieutenant governor under the constitution. The party in power has the power to legislate, with the exception of certain entries in list 2. Under list 2, I think entry 1, 2, 18, 65, 66 are excluded from the domain of the Legislative Assembly. What are those entries? Police, land, and offences, etc., related to those entries. It's again a very interesting interplay of federalism in the state capital. And as you know, all this while things went well. That's the political dimension of it. If the party in the centre and the party in the state or the union territory, as the case is in the case of the NCT, are one, it's fine. When the Aam Aadmi comes in as a challenger, then they are shown the rule book. Now the same question I started by talking to you about the interplay between legislative entries, the same question arises there in a slightly different avatar. When you say land under 18, what does it extend to? When you say police, is it the actual operation of the police force, or does it include appointment of persons to the police? I'm giving you loose examples, and this case is pending in the Supreme Court. But how will this case be decided? How will any of these cases that I have talked to you about be decided, except on the principle of constitutional morality, a healthy respect for a federal structure? Even when you're deciding pith and substance, now some of you must have read about the Surfacey judgment in Jammu and Kashmir. As you know, the JNK is a separate case study, Article 370. It has its own constitutional provisions. It has its own enactments. One of those enactments is the JNK Transfer of Property Act. That act says no property in Kashmir shall be transferred to a non-resident. Now you have Surfacey, that is the Securitization Act, under which banks have the power to seize assets and sell them. It's a central enactment. A very interesting question arose. Does the power of the secured creditor under Surfacey, while acquiring or bringing an asset to sale, does that power fall foul of Section 140 of the JNK Transfer Property Act? When a bank attaches an asset and sells it because of a default, does it mean that in Jammu and Kashmir it can only sell it to a resident? And the Supreme Court, now we must read that judgment. Justice Rowington's judgment has clearly held that under the federal structure, though JNK under Article 370 and its own constitutional order stands on a separate footing, there is no gainsaying that certain powers which vest in the centre under the union list, of which one is banking, are not subservient. And therefore it was ultimately held that the Securitization Act prevails over the JNK Transfer of Property Act. That's a legal understanding. I told you courts are the arbiters. Please look at the political interplay there. Please look at how different our structures are. Within our framework, union territories on one footing, states on another, JNK on another, panchayats on another. And that interplay is what defines Indian federalism. Nobody has been able to define Indian federalism. People have played safe. Many times people have said, leave it to the circumstances. It's fine. But those circumstances should also not become such that states should either become bullies or get bullied.
Kaveri water dispute. And let me make it very clear, friends, whatever I am talking to you about here is in my personal capacity, it's not as the additional AG. Right? Because some of the things I am talking to you about are very, very sensitive matters in Karnataka, and I believe I am not saying anything out of line, but for the record, even on the Kaveri issue, if one looks at the stand that the center has taken over the years, it's not always been consistent. It's always kept an eye on who's in power in Karnataka, who's in power in Tamil Nadu, which way is the wind blowing. Even on a very interesting constitutional question, whether a right of SLP is available to you against an award passed by the water tribunal, the stand of the center was peculiar. Do you know, under the Indian constitution, an award passed by a water disputes tribunal can be made final to the exclusion even of the Supreme Court. And the Indian constitution says it. So there is no question of judicial review being violated by amendment. The Indian constitution gives you judicial review on one hand, on the other hand it says water disputes, even Supreme Court can be excluded. And the enactment dealing with water disputes says an award once passed and notified shall be final. So an argument was taken by the Tamil Nadu government that final means final within the meaning of Article 262 of the Indian Constitution. And therefore even the remedy of special leave petition under Article 36 is excluded. Of course the Supreme Court held that remedy is not ousted. It only makes it final at a level of original interpretation. But I would like you all to study this closer, to see what was the stand of the center in the Kaveri. The Kaveri water dispute is still ongoing. But what has been the stand of the center on this issue? And you will find shifting flagposts. Finally, friends, I want to conclude. I told you I will talk to you very briefly about the beef and the flag issue. Again on beef, a very interesting development. An interplay of food, religion, prevention of cruelty to animals. The law was introduced by Parliament by way of subordinate legislation under the Prevention of Cruelty Act, but its spirit, if one looks at it, and especially if you look at it from the perspective of certain states where beef is consumed and the citizens of that state, was that you are not so much legislating on prevention of cruelty, which you have the power. What you are effectively doing is dealing with cattle, which is a state subject, and dealing with food, which is already covered. And even if it is food, then bring an amendment to food law. Don't bring an amendment to prevention of cruelty to animals law. It's a legal argument, and the Madras High Court accepted it. I am not taking a personal stand on it. The Madras High Court accepted it, stayed the rules. The stay continues in the Supreme Court. And the center has submitted in the Supreme Court that it will revisit it. But it's a very interesting question, friends. Legislative power is one thing. What is the driving force behind an amendment? What is the politics of the day? Something like consumption of beef for a long period of time has been a non-issue, more or less. It's today suddenly the issue. And it's an issue not so much about cruelty to animals, it's a much larger question. It's a larger question of religious sentiment. Triple talaq is a question of religious sentiment. People say triple talaq is a case dealing with women's rights. Of course it is. But the elephant in the room is still the religious aspect. And let's not wish those things away. And those are the parts between the lines in the constitution, which the constitution will not tell you. But you have to read with nuance to understand what the political interplay is. And many times that interplay in each of these cases brings states and the center at cross purposes. It sometimes brings the people and the state at cross purposes. Sometimes some states are happy and other states are not, which we have seen. Even there, under Article 131, the Constitution provides for resolution of disputes inter se. But in each of these, as I have said, the interpretation made by the Supreme Court, and more importantly, the interpretation made by the people is crucial. You may win or lose cases in courts, but many times the political ramifications are different. And these things can, people say demonetization, it's virtually upheld by the Supreme Court. What are its political implications? We don't know. We will only know in the next election. But there's no doubt that it's an issue that people will think about. And not all states have been in favor. As you know, demonetization was a top secret operation. Many of the state governments didn't even know it was happening. People have said it's not in the spirit of federalism. You should have involved the states. On the other hand, the center says that's also an argument. Something this serious, beyond three or four people in New Delhi, nobody else knew. And we can continue to debate this. Well, it's a pun on beef till the cows come home. And yes, the flag issue, I don't want to say much. It's a sensitive issue also. It's a matter that's pending consideration. People have said a lot about it. To be honest, to my knowledge at least, the government of Karnataka has not taken a stand on it. It's at an exploration level. But the Indian legal system doesn't forbid states from having flags. And flags by themselves are symbolisms. We had flags in school. In fact, not just school flags, we even had house flags. And what did those flags do? A house flag, if we use a loose example, if the school flag was the union flag and the house flag was a state flag, the house flag always flew lower than the school flag. And the house flags came together with the school flag to give you a sense of identity, of diversity and unity in one, which I believe is the spirit of the Indian Constitution. I'm not here to make out a case of sedition. I'm not here to say a state flag means a state flag flies above a union flag. I mean, I'm not using this only in a literal sense, that a state flag means a state has a Balkanist tendency to disintegrate. That's a secessionist argument. That's a separate argument, and obviously I'm not making that. But in spirit, if a state flag gives people an identity, gives them a socio-cultural identity, it is done in keeping with the National Emblems Act, the Flags Code, the national flag comes first. I think it's actually a very poignant illustration of what we've been talking about all along, which is cooperative federalism. Federalism doesn't mean only the center. Federalism means both the center and the states. It's a happy harmony of the two. And if two flags mean better cooperative federalism, then so be it. Thank you. Over to you.